Thank you. Mobility. What does mobility mean for a young girl from the Detroit of Germany? What does mobility mean for an 82-year-old man called Ed? And what does mobility mean for Susan, who just moved to Frankfurt for her job? For all three, and I think for all of us, mobility means more than vehicles, much more. Today, let me show you what this more can mean. Let us start with the first person. Can you imagine being a 7-year-old girl, be born 1993? You have brown eyes and street dog blondish hair. You're born and raised in Rüsselsheim, the founding place of Opel. A former farming village that no one really knew in the area became that industrial city with over 65,000 inhabitants and well-known all over Germany. Only because of one guy, Adam Opel, who had a new vision for mobility. For that little girl, it was normal that there were only Opel cars on the street and that all of her relatives, or most of her relatives, were working for Opel. And then when she visited friends, that their relatives had Opels in their driveway and also worked for Opel. Can you imagine this? Then you can imagine me. Working for an automotive manufacturer was deeply woven into my family's DNA. I can remember conversations with my grandfathers, both of them, working on the assembly line for Opel, getting up at 4 a.m. in the morning, going into the manufacturing halls where engines screaming at him, steam in the air, and in the middle, there was this conveyor belt where cars just one after the other were rolling off towards a new future. Basically, all true to the motto of Henry Ford, who said, "You can have a car in any color as long as it's black." But that was not important for my grandfather's generation or for my grandfather. For him, mobility meant cars, and cars meant freedom. Owning one, unfortunately, was not possible for him. They were just too rare and too expensive. This changed over the years. Cars became more and more a commodity. I don't know if it's only true for myself, but when I think back to conversations with my parents, it was always like, can you remember that great vacation we had with the Red Manta? Or which color should our next leasing vehicle be? Don't you think that new rims would look great with that interior design? So mobility still meant cars, but now suddenly they adjusted to our individual wish and demand. And that is where I come from. That's how I saw mobility for a long time. Now, let's move to the second person, Ed. Can you imagine being an 82-year-old man living in our world today? Due to the death of your wife, you are living alone in your apartment, like many other elderly people do. And by the way, like 42% in general nowadays do, 42%. Coming back to Ed, your children moved off and lived their own life. One in Berlin and one in Japan. Via WhatsApp, you're getting pictures from their adventures. Just yesterday, you got one from your daughter from her trip to Fuji with that impressive bullet train. In your own little world, adventures got less and less. And mobility-wise, there are no Shinkansen in sight. Half a year ago, you had to give up your car with a heavy heart because you almost hit a cyclist while you tried to make a turn. But this traffic nowadays just got so crowded and your eyes are not the greatest anymore. Ever since, your children are in your ears telling you that you should be using public transportation. So you said on your wedding day, when you wanted to cook something nice from your wife's cookbook and you needed to get some special ingredients from that supermarket across the city, you said, "I'm gonna give it a try. I'm using that public transportation." And with that, the hustle began. Here's just different than Japan or Berlin. There's no bus connection on every corner. And even though there is a bus line, it doesn't seem to go directly where you needed to go. So it took you 2 hours to get to the supermarket. And by the time you got back home, you were just plain exhausted and didn't feel to have the energy to cook at all. Well, you said that canned soup that you get from the Lidl store several hundred meters away would do it for now and the future. What about your social life? Well, the regular bowlers table that happened every Wednesday stopped as no members were coming anymore. And the old crew from your neighborhood that you used to know, they one after the other moved away, or like Herbert 2 weeks ago, died. Your new neighbors you find hard to get in contact to. They always seem so busy with their smartphones and you don't want to disturb them. And you definitely don't want to ask for their help. But, you know, you have positive sides in your life. Every day, your friend the mailman comes and brings you that nice advertising booklets that you like to go through. Or your other highlight, the quarterly haircut that you get from that nice hairdresser who always asks you how you're doing. A question nobody else has asked you since your last haircut. That is what I fight against. That is not how I want to live in the future. What brings me to a third person, Susan. Can you imagine being a 28-year-old young professional who just moved to Frankfurt for her job? Due to the incredible high renting prices that you have in the city center, you decided to move to the suburban area around the city center. You're living in an apartment building with 5 floors and 15 other apartments at least. Out of ecological reasons, you decided against getting a car. That piece of metal is standing 23 hours a day anyway and takes up space worth living in. However, retrospectively, that piece of metal would have been very handy when you needed to get the IKEA Billy closet and all the nitty things that you just needed to buy at the IKEA store from the store to your new apartment. That near meltdown you faced while you tried to get everything up the stairs into the rarely coming S-Bahn and then the even less often coming bus could have been easily missed by you. But those fancy sharing options that are available in the city center are just not available in your neighborhood. So what else could she have done? Or could you have done? Social-wise, you're connected with people and friends all around the world. You're frequently chatting with Nico from Paris, Cody from the US, and Sophie from Norway. But in your immediate neighborhood, you find it difficult to get in contact with people. Even though sometimes you do see other residents, like that friendly-looking elderly man from down the street, but with no anchor point, you find it, you never start a conversation. So you keep yourself busy at work, but when you're getting back home to an empty apartment, making something quick and easy for dinner, because honestly, cooking alone is just not worth it. And then while you're sitting there in front of your computer, looking through thousands of Netflix options, telling you stories about happy couples, happy friends, or happy family, you do feel very lonely from time to time. And out of this, I want to create change. So far, we learned that mobility can mean freedom. If it's adjusted to our individual demand, we are even more willing to use the respective vehicle. If we don't have any mobility options left, we can feel imprisoned. Currently, new mobility formats leave a big percentage of the population behind. And we are all living in a world today in which people feel more and more isolated and lonely. So, now imagine your new form of mobility for Ed and Susan, a mobility that flexibly adjusts to their individual demand, and a form of mobility that is as individual as we as humans can be. So take Susan, for example. If it's raining and she needs to take a business call on her way to a theater, for example, wouldn't it be great if she could use a car? And if it's sunny and she's in a sporty mood, it would be great if she could use a bicycle. Or take Ed. If he's feeling well and he's in a communicative mood and needs something from the grocery store, wouldn't it be great if he could ride to that grocery store together with other residents in one car. Or if he's not feeling well because he's having a flu, but urgently need that cough syrup, wouldn't it be great if Susan, who's passing by a pharmacy anyway, could pick up that cough syrup and bring it to him? That's how I envision the mobility of our future. And to enabling this, my colleagues and I, we developed three functions. First, a station-based vehicle sharing system, right for neighborhoods. We are providing to that neighborhood a flexible vehicle fleet that can contain cars, bicycle, cargo bikes, or motor scooters. The final selection of these vehicles is done together with the residents, so with Ed and Susan. Second, a ride-sharing options for the community. Via our platform, people or residents with the same direction or the same destinations can find each other and can ride together. So in our example, if Ed needs to go to the grocery store and Susan needs to go there as well, they could ride together. And third, a bring-along function. Via digital shopping lists, Ed could communicate what he needs in terms of daily goods to Susan that could pick it up for him and bring it to him. Now you might question yourself, that sounds great for Ed, but what is in it for Susan? Well, we believe everyone who's bringing him or herself into the community and it's doing something positive and helping others in the community should be rewarded. So we developed an incentivation system for the function 2 and 3. That means if Susan is bringing something to Ed or is taking Ed to another place, she's getting, besides a verbal thank you, a financial thank you. Another question I get frequently asked, or I'm still getting frequently asked, is how can I motivate people like Ed to start using the platform, to feel comfortable enough with that technology to use it? For this, we tried to create a very inclusive approach. We are providing introduction events, personal introduction events, and software tutorials for the people in the neighborhoods. By doing so, we can give elderly or not so technology-oriented people a personal answer to the question, where do I get the app? How does it work? Can I do something wrong? And all of this, I think, makes mobility more. I envision a world in which all these three functions can be tied together to create a more individual mobility. But believe me, that wasn't always easy. When I started this in May 2019, I really thought all of this could be done and rolled out within 3 months. Yeah, that did not work. Reality kicked in with development issues, with funding questions, who's gonna pay for all of this? And longer than expected decision cycles on the customer side. And believe me, there were moments when I thought, wouldn't it be just easier to go back to your normal job that you also really enjoy a lot? But no, let me also tell you, the moment when you get the funding or when you see the first or the smile on the first customer's face, this is so worth it. So I told you where I come from, I told you what I fight against, and let me tell you again, what I work for. I envision a world in which mobility means more than vehicles, in which customization is not targeted at single individuals, but to local communities, in which the true sense and meaning of sharing is reinvented, in which it does not simply mean to share assets or vehicles, but to share social values like responsibility, sustainability, and caring for each other. If you could imagine all of this, then you took the first step towards change. Thank you.